Here's LaPointe over to Mondu. Mondu trying to feed it to LaFleur. LaFleur for LaPointe. LaPointe trying to work around. Doak broke it up. Jonathan's back on. Canadiens, Lambert in the corner. Lambert centers and Doak intercepts. Here's Jonathan trying to take a pass, but checked by Lambert. And Doak cleared it to the Montreal line. Nyer up, lost it to Marcotte. Marcotte to Jonathan. The pass is behind it. Mondu feeds Cournoyer. Now Jonathan for Boston. Boston to Cournoyer. Into Mondu on right wing. Smith after him. Mondu shooting well wide of the net as it went off Cheever's stick. Now Cashman to Jonathan. In for Schmatz. Over to Cashman. LaPointe keeping an eye on him. It's Standard Dryden. Got a stick on it. And Nyer up beats Degeney. Now to Cournoyer. And that hops over his stick. Cournoyer carries it back. Got it wide on his backhander, and Gainey couldn't get a stick on it. Now Gainey shot the flex wide. Here's O'Reilly. Gated off by Jarvis. Park ducks under a check from Gainey. Park for the Bruins. Backhanding it in front of the Montreal goal. Savard has it. Third Savard checked by O'Reilly. McNabb comes in. And Hull comes back to help out for Montreal. To Gainey. Off his stick to center. Milbury to McNabb. Bruins trailing 2-1. Here is O'Reilly setting up McNabb, but the play is offside at the Montreal blue line.
And we'll join Dave Hodge now in our studios.
In our second intermission, I'll be talking to Masterton Trophy winner Butch Goring of the Los Angeles Kings. We'll hear Lou Nanny's comparison of the defensive units of these teams. More from Chico Resch and a look at Ken Dryden before the game.
Scoring the Masterton winner here. Our congratulations to Bobby Crum, coach of the Detroit Red Wings, selected by the NHL Broadcasters Association as coach of the year.
And he wins the Jack Adams trophy. Here is Middleton trying to center it. Now Savard for Gainey. Gainey at center ice to Hull. In across the Bruin line. Milbury trying to clear it. Robinson held it in. A shot that hit someone in front of the net and gave Cheevers problems. And he finally got his glove on it.
Exactly 1 minute to go in the period. You know, Chico, although the Canadians have dominated things so much territorially in the second period, it's still only a 2-1 hockey game. And if the Bruins, you know, could pop one to tie it, the Canadians could sag after doing everything but scoring. They've had some great chances. Never know.
That's right. That's right. They dominated, but the name of the game is still put the puck in the net, and they have been able to finish off, but they've come awful close.
Here's Jarvis, now a back for a hander by Gainey that Cheever's just got his stick on. O'Reilly dumps it back for Milbury to Middleton. Middleton trying to shoot it in, Savard intercepting. Here's Gainey. Now Rattel to Middleton around Savard. Pulled down by Hull, and Robinson cleared it away, and there's going to be a penalty to Hull.
All right, that was a quick chance, just what you were talking about, Chico, and Rajan Hull drew what I think is known in the trade as a pretty good penalty, because Middleton may be an excellent one. Yeah, right. He was in a pretty cold that time.
Montreal penalty to number 15, Rajan Hull.
Well, you have to remember who's getting the chance here. We all know Rick Middleton handles the puck so well. And there it could have even been Serge Savard who originally clipped him. But regardless, it was a good call, a good penalty. And if you want to take a penalty, if you have to take a penalty, it's nice if it's broken up at the end of a period and then to start the next period.
Well, Middleton pulled down by Hull, who gets a tripping penalty with 42 seconds left in the second period. Montreal leading 2-1. Here are the Bruins on the power play. Park drive wide of the net by 3 or 4 feet, and the Canadiens clear down the ice. And that was a real rocket that Park set sail. Schmatz to O'Reilly. Now Jarvis. Savard cleared it to the Bruin line. Brad Park on left wing to Schmatz. Not centering it. Shepard tried to reach back. Lemire slaps it off the boards. Here's Jarvis after a loose puck, but Schmatz recovers quickly for Boston. 12 seconds left in the period. Bruins with the man advantage. Park turns to get away from Lemire. Now passes to Schmatz. 2 seconds left. Long shot. Dryden steers it to the corner as the buzzer goes to end the second period. And the only goal of that period by Larry Robinson from Mondu at the 7-minute mark to give the Canadiens the lead. And so the score at the end of the second period, the Montreal Canadiens 2, the Boston Bruins 1.
Hey there, dreaming of the sun.
Row with us.
Hey there, looking for some fun.
Row with us. Making sure the grass is green.
Checking out the listening scene.
Come on, everybody, row with us.
Scotiabank. It's the place to save for the things you want now. A month from now. A year from now.
Come to Scotiabank and row with us. Row with us. Row with us. Row with us.
On the nights I make dinner, we have chicken. Everybody raves about my chicken.
Dinner's ready.
Really good. Finger-licking good. Salads, French fries, and Grecian bread. Great dinner. My friend the Colonel taught me everything I know.
Dinner's ready at Kentucky Fried Chicken.
How to help provide early warning protection against fire. No two fires begin the same way. Sometimes they start as simply as this. To help protect your family, General Electric developed the Home Sentry Smoke Alarm System. When this sensitive device detects smoke, it sounds a warning, providing time for escape. The GE Home Sentry System. It could help save your family's lives. Canadian General Electric, working to give you your money's worth.
The Canadians score the only goal of the second period. Larry Robinson from Pierre Mondeau at the 7-minute mark. And though there were 58 minutes in penalties in the opening period, there was only one power play opportunity. We had four minors in the second period, two power play chances for each team. The Bruins' second will carry over to the third period as Réjean Houle is off for the Montreal Canadiens. With me now, and it's a pleasure to have him, Butch Goring of the Los Angeles Kings, who was named on Friday of this week at the annual NHL luncheon as the winner of the Bill Masterton Memorial Trophy, which is awarded for dedication and perseverance to hockey. Means different things to different people, Butch. To some, an unsung hero. What does it mean to you?
Well, it means the sports writers are watching the game of hockey, and it's nice that they can think of me as a player of the same type of caliber as a Bobby Clark or a Jean Rattel, who are past winners of the Masterton Trophy. So it's nice to be put in that kind of a class.
We talked before this season about your candidacy for the Lady Byng Trophy, which is awarded for gentlemanly and outstanding play, and of course your penalty total has always been very low. Do you think that comes into play with the Masterton Trophy?
Well, I think it certainly helps, though the Masterton Trophy is not as much how well you do as far as assists and goals are. It's more of, you know, what you put into the game and how hard you work at it and that sort of thing, whereas the Lady Byng is a little more of, you know, your outstanding ability. Certainly, winning either one is a great thing in anybody's career.
You made a statement in accepting the trophy that I don't think a lot of people would think about, relating your win to a player who has never won the Masterton Trophy.
Well, certainly, as we all know how great a player Bobby Orr is, and he's won every trophy, so I feel that the Masterton Trophy must be a tough one to grab since he never got it.
The Los Angeles Kings have done well through your services for several years. There is a chance he will not be back there, and I must ask you about negotiations with the Kings since you were a free agent. Are you close to anything with them, or what might happen next year?
Well, nothing's really happening right now. I'm just going to wait till June 1st and see what the other teams think I'm worth, and see what kind of a player they think I am, and you know, we'll just go from there. Naturally, I'd like to be in LA, but I got, you know, my family, and I've got my own self to think about, and hey, everybody else is grabbing the big dollar, I might as well try and get part of it.
Butch, what about this game? It's had several things worth talking about. What has caught your eye?
Well, the basic part of the game that I like so far is the way that, you know, the checking, the really close checking. Each team has been, you know, taking the man on every chance they get, and neither teams are getting great scoring chances other than, you know, when it's a power player or a breakaway type style.
Jerry Cheever's holding Boston in, do you think? Because the tougher saves have certainly been his.
Oh, absolutely. I think without Jerry Cheever's playing as well as he's been playing, the game wouldn't really be close. I think Cheever's the other night played excellent, and tonight you can't fault him on anything.
Butch, thank you for being with us, and congratulations on winning the Masterton Trophy, not considered one of the major NHL awards, but its meaning, a name for the late Bill Masterton of the Minnesota North Stars. And for dedication and perseverance, I think there is a lot of meaning behind winning the trophy, and I know you are justifiably proud. Butch Goring of the Los Angeles Kings, next Lou Nanny, as Stanley Cup 78 continues in just a moment.
Board of Canada's DuraGuard system, our commitment to you.
A year ago, we demonstrated Ford's protective vinyl coating to show you its effectiveness in reducing paint damage caused by stone chipping. We've extended its use this year. Now every 1978 North American-built Ford of Canada car has even more protection from stone chipping. Here's another step in Ford of Canada's DuraGuard system. Electrocoating is applied to almost all of our 1978 cars sold in Canada. The car body is dipped into primer paint, and the body sheet metal and the primer are given opposite electrical charges. The primer is attracted to the metal, and hard-to-reach nooks and crannies are better protected from rust corrosion. The DuraGuard system is standard with every 1978 North American-built Ford and Lincoln Mercury car sold in Canada, and is backed by a no-extra-charge 36-month unlimited-distance warranty against rust perforation. The DuraGuard system. At Ford, we're committed to quality, reliability, and durability. And to you.
The overcoat. Canadians have long known its true meaning. Protection, durability, value. And for our homes, we need Olympic overcoat. Overcoat, specially formulated to cover old paint. Easy to apply and long-lasting. Olympic guarantees it. Give your home the beauty and protection of Olympic, the great Canadian overcoat.
Get away, make your getaway from the city.
For 50 years, more people in the world have been getting away with Johnson's than with any other outboard.
With the Canadians leading the Bruins 2-1, we talk in this second intermission with Lou Nanny of the Minnesota North Stars about the defensive units of these two teams. It's always going to be important to watch the defensemen when the Canadians play. It is turning out that the play of the two defensive units is very important in this series. Larry Robinson has the go-ahead goal tonight. The Bruins have had a goal from a defenseman in each of the three previous games. But there is a basic difference when you've got superstars on one side and Brad Park and journeyman, shall we say, on the other.
Well, actually, you can't call them journeymen. They're very solid defensemen. But what they do best, and that being the Boston defense, is they play within their limitations. I have to commend Don Cherry very much because he has them playing the way they should play. They've got Brad Park that is a superstar defenseman. He can do everything, rush the puck. But as you know, he doesn't let Park rush it. As a matter of fact, if anybody can rush the puck in that club, it looks like Milbury stays in deeper than Park, and Park is the better carry. So you'd have to say that he lets them just do what they do best, and that's just stay back, play defense, take the body, throw the puck around the boards. The wing's responsibility, as we said in earlier shows, is to get it out. Now, Montreal's defense is quite different. They've got three all-around defensemen. Robinson, Savard, as you know, play together, and they both carry the puck extremely well. Lapointe plays the same way. He carries the puck extremely well. Now, Billy Nyrop is the defensive defenseman of the four, and so would be Pierre Bouchard when he's out there. What Montreal has changed tonight, those three defensemen in particular, and every now and then Nyrop, have been able to move that puck up the middle. Where they were getting shut off on the boards the last game in Boston, they didn't come up the middle, so they were getting hemmed in their own zone. Consequently, they weren't getting the puck into Boston's zone. They had no chances. Tonight, they're even lofting high passes if they have nobody to pass it to, but they keep throwing the puck up the middle. And when they have opportunity, tonight they're beating that first man, and there's not much room here. That tells you how good that Montreal defense is because they're able to stick handle by a man and make that pass.
There's a tendency in talking about the Montreal defense to talk about three people. We see Nyrop tonight. We did not see him in game three. Do you think his presence is helping Montreal's defense play better, which I think is an obvious fact?
Well, not only his presence. We have to remember that Montreal lost a game to Detroit earlier this year in the playoffs. Nyrop didn't play. They lost a game here the other night. Nyrop didn't play. The last time they lost to Boston, Nyrop didn't play. And it's just because this is his style rink, outside the fact that he's a real good defenseman. He plays a solid defensive game. He clears the front of the net well. He doesn't make mistakes. He's able to skate the puck out because he's so strong. People tend to think that Bouchard is the strongest Montreal hockey player. Well, he's not. Bouchard is one of their best fighters, if not their best. Nyrop physically is their strongest. Through all conditioning tests and that, he's been proven to be their strongest. And he's able to move people around quite effectively back there.
Lou, I think the people who watched the first period specifically and saw the two fights that took place might have been wondering whether there would be any impact or the game from what happened in the fights. It is a long-standing theory that that can lift the team that that wins it, and there's no doubt that the Bruins came out ahead. And yet, since that point, it's my opinion the Canadians have been stronger.
Well, that's Montreal's great trait. They can do anything you want. You want to fight, they fight. You want to skate, they skate. You want to pass the puck, they pass the puck. And tonight, even though, as we said, they were beaten in the fights, they came right back and played aggressive, which just shows you that they're going to play a solid type of hockey game. They're here to win this game tonight. And the way they're playing right now, they're going to be tough to beat. Had it not been for Cheevers, the score would be much higher. But this power play starting the third period is all important for Boston.
Larry Robinson has put the Montreal Canadiens in front by a score of 2-1 after a couple of early goals in the first period that preceded those two fights. We thank Lou Nanny, and we look forward to hearing from Chico Resch with Dick Irvin as we return with the Stanley Cup playoffs in a moment.
A season premiere. The CBC series This Land, looking to the past, looking to the future, and focusing on Canada and Canadians. The story of East Coast lighthouses and the people who manned them. On Voices from the Rapids, follow the old voyageur routes down the French River. House of Trees traces the development of log building in Canada. And the Polar People, a look at the Arctic today and the Inuit with Farley Mowat. Watch the season premiere of This Land.
1 week from tonight on CBC.
CBC Thursday, the elegance of Edwardian England and the rags-to-riches story of Louisa Trotter, the Duchess of Duke Street. From cook to hotel owner, she got there by using her sharp tongue.
Going out, Mrs. Brown. She's having hysterics over a mix-up with her button boots.
Now, you take a good look now, because that's all you're going to see of me tonight.
And her charm.
Just so we know where we stand.
The Duchess of Duke Street, premiering Thursday, June 1st.
The John Deere 400 tractor, a powerhouse of versatility. Rotary mower, hydraulic controls at your fingertips. You control the cut. Rotary tiller, rear PTO supplies the drive, digs deep and wide. Front end loader, power steering lets you handle up to 600 pounds capacity with ease. And moving parts are enclosed for safety and quiet. With a full range of tractors and attachments, including snow thrower, there's no job too tough. Proof, nothing runs like a Deere.
We are in the second intermission of Game 4 Stanley Cup Finals. Montreal in front of the Boston Bruins 2-1. And before we get to Dick Irvin with Chico Resch, we'd like to show you something of what goes on in the goal crease with Ken Dryden specifically prior to a game. And then hear some of his thoughts about what a goalie thinks about while the game is in progress.
Why I start at the right post, I really don't know, but it's something that I've always done, and I make one turn of the ice across to the left and then turn around and go back, and then one across the top of the crease, just outside the crease, the premise being anyway that to make the ice a little bit slower so that in moving across I'll be able to stop a little bit more quickly. The approach of a goaltender to playing his position, I think, is different than the approach of anybody else playing another position. You have direct involvement that other players on the team don't, that at times it is very much a one-on-one situation and you having to deal with it. However, most of the time the position is not overwhelmingly romantic and you see yourself more as a target than you do as a gladiator.
The physical gyrations of Ken Dryden before a game are always interesting to study. That helps us study his mind and what goes on in Ken Dryden's head as the game is about to start, and he does some gardening, so to speak, if that can be done on ice. Chico Resch will tell us more with Dicker.
The Canadians have the lead 2-1 at the end of two periods, and Chico, you mentioned to me just now, you watched the Bruins for a while as the game got going, and you saw something a bit different.
Well, that's right. I noticed it when they came on the ice to start the game. You could kind of feel it in the crowd. There was a little bit of apprehension, hesitation. And I think, you know, the third game is obviously an important game, too. But when you win that third game at home, you realize you have time to think about the fact now it's the fourth game, and now that is really the important game. And sometimes you think about it too much. And to start the game, the crowd, where they were spontaneous and there was electricity, but it wasn't just kind of coming out of them. And it was the same thing with the players, I thought. You know, they'd just been hesitating a little bit more. But, of course, the big reason why is they're playing against a pretty good hockey team tonight.
Chico, the Canadians, I think, really are kind of taking a page out of the Bruins' book. the way Boston played against them on Thursday. They're just not letting them get started so far.
That's correct. And, you know, I think if you talked to anybody before this series, you said, what's the big difference between the two teams? They'd say the defense. Montreal's defense, mobile, move the puck quick. You say Boston's defense, it was suspect. You know, the guys aren't quite as quick. They don't handle the puck as well. Well, Montreal hasn't dumped the puck in and put the pressure on the defense. Tonight, they changed all that. It's kind of a dump and run game, and nobody runs better than Montreal. And like we were talking, you know, Gainey and Houle and those guys are just flying in there right on top of the Montreal defense, the Boston defense. The Boston defense doesn't have time to look what they're doing with the puck. And so, therefore, that's creating a lot of opportunities and a lot of havoc in the Boston zone.
Zico, just very briefly, as the teams return to the ice, my theory is the next goal, if there is one in this hockey game, is very large.
Well, I'll go on the spot with you, Dick, and I would agree with that, no question. The next one, I think it's going to be the biggie.
Okay, Chico Rush, thank you very much. The Canadians and the Boston Bruins back out onto the ice here at the Boston Garden as we get set for the third period of this fourth game in the Stanley Cup Finals. The Canadians have the lead here tonight, 2-1, with a recap of what's gone on statistically. Here again is Dan Kelly.
Okay, Dick Urban. Those fellows talking about the goals that are about to come. The only one of the second period was scored by Larry Robinson, his third of the year from Mondew at the seven-minute mark. In the first period, Shepherd had scored for the Bruins, Risebrough for Montreal, and then Robinson in the second period of the seven-minute mark. Montreal outshooting the Bruins 7-5 in that second period. Canadians now in the game with 17 shots on goal to 13 for Boston.
And a reminder that we'll be on the air at 8 o'clock Eastern Time from the Forum in Montreal Tuesday night for Game 5 of this Stanley Cup Final. That's the 23rd. Tonight being the 21st marks the latest date that either of these teams have ever played. The Canadians, their latest date was the 18th of May in the 7th and final game of the final in 1971 in Chicago. I don't know what the Bruins' latest date. The series, if it went the limit, would conclude on the 27th, next Saturday. That would equal the longest Stanley Cup final. The Flyers and the Sabres went that long in 1975. Okay, Dan, we're set.
Rajah Houle in the penalty box, a minute 18 to serve. The Bruins trail 2-1. They start this period on the power play. Here's Savard for Montreal. Lost it to Rattel. Over to Schmatz, right in. Right in the pad save as he came out to challenge the shooter. Here's Mark Kott for Rattel. Trying to get away from Lapointe. Now Jarvis gets it free, and Lapointe flips it into the Boston end of the ring. A minute left in Houle's penalty. Park for Shepherd. Now to Rattel. He dropped it back. Gainey intercepting. Never got a shot away. And now carries back to center ice. Gives it to Lapointe. He dumps it into the Bruins zone, and Shepherd takes over for Boston. On right wing for Park to Schmatz. Schmatz into Rattel, and it's offside at the Montreal blue line with 36 seconds left in Houle's penalty.
There is Jean Rattel, 12 years in the playoffs in his career with the New York Rangers and the Boston Bruins. Tonight, his 104th Stanley Cup game. He has never played on a Stanley Cup winner. As some hockey player, and he has been frustrated this far in his career.
These two teams have gone through 23 power plays now without scoring a goal. Not since game one of this series has either team been able to score on the power play. Here's Shepherd. 30 seconds left in Houle's penalty. Greg Shepherd headmanning it on right wing to Park. Park to Schmatz. Schmatz cuts over onto the other wing. Tried to make a play to Shepherd. Gainey had him tied up, and Lapointe cleared it away. Jerry Cheever flips it off the glass for Marcotte. To Schmatz. In against Lapointe. Schmatz, a quick shot. Bryden reached up with that left leg of his to kick it away. Here's Park centering to Rattel. Rattel back to Schmatz. Shoots Bryden, a pad save, and he grabbed the rebound just as Houle returns to the ice from the penalty box. And Dryden has some words with Brad Park. From the Boston Garden, this is Stanley Cup 78.
Is a quartz watch you can trust?
Yeah?
It has electronic quartz accuracy.
Quartz? That's advanced.
Plus, Bulova Accutron dependability.
Bulova Accutron? Now that's dependable.
Introducing the new Bulova Accutron Quartz.
Ah.
Beautiful and slim. Unbeatably accurate.
Oh?
And virtually maintenance-free.
I like it. I feel I can trust it.
We hoped you would.
Kelly with Dick Urban and Chico Resch in the broadcast booth at Boston Garden. Canadians 2, the Bruins 1. Faceoff, Risebrough against McNabb. Into the corner, Robinson firing it out on the boards for Yvonne Lambert. He tried to clear it, Doak held it in. Gary Doak bumped by Lambert. Now it's Nyarov trying to clear it. Middleton held it in. His shot went off a skate. Here's Mario Tremblay. Got it to the Bruin line, and Smith has it for Boston. Smith checked by Tremblay. Now McNabb for O'Reilly. Nyarov skates him off, and Risebrough comes up with the puck. Doug Risebrough, a lead pass to Lambert. He and Doak chasing after it. Lambert got to it, but Smith came back to help out for Boston. Trying to clear it. Robinson holding it in. And now the Bruins dump it down the ice. Nyarov back to touch it, and it's icing against the Bruins.
The Canadians will be flying home immediately after this game. They will practice at the Forum late tomorrow morning in Montreal. The Bruins will leave Boston at noontime tomorrow and practice in Montreal when they get there later in the afternoon. Scotty Bowman's record in the playoffs. The first coach in the playoffs, Dan, back in, 1968, when he was leading the St. Louis Blues, and they made it to the finals 3 years in a row, the first 3 years of the expanded NHL.
Faceoff will be to the left of the Bruin goal. Lemire against Shepard. Bruins come up with the puck, and Milbury got away from Schutt, starts out on right wing. Mike Milbury flips it into the Montreal zone. Dryden there to grab it because Shepard and Milbury were both coming in the area of the Montreal goal, so Dryden took no chances.
As we look at Ken Dryden, I got to give him an awful lot of credit along with the rest of the Canadian team. He got that early goal 25 seconds into the game, and since then he's been just razor sharp. And
here's Shepard from the faceoff, tried to center. Lemire checked him. Marcotte held it in, but Serge Savard feeds it into the center ice area. Schmotz missed it. Here's Schutt for Lafleur. Tied up by Schmotz. Lafleur trying to center for Schutt, and at least Cheevers cleared it away. Now it's Shepard. Lead pass to Schmotz. Robinson has him tied up, and Robinson feeds to Lafleur. All the way down into the Bruin zone. Cheevers firing it up himself to Milbury. To Shepard. Savard breaks it up at the Montreal line, gives to Robinson to Schutt. Schutt flipping it into the Bruin zone. Milbury back with Lemire. Lemire trying to kick it loose. He does. Cashman is there, drops it to Milbury. Milbury lost it. Here's Houle, shoots one, and that's high off the glass. Marcotte skated off by Gainey. Now Milbury works his way into the Canadian zone to Cashman, and Jarvis was there in that defensive role to poke it back to center. Park for Milbury. Into Cashman. Drops it to Milbury. Here is LaPointe. He flipped it to the center ice red line, and now Gary Doak has it for Boston to Stan Jonathan. Jonathan bumped by Gainey. Gainey gives to Houle. Jarvis was already in ahead of the play. So Houle circles back to center, waits for his teammate to get onside, dumped it in. Jonathan on left wing, feeds to Cashman. Nyarov hustling back to get the loose puck for the Canadians. Bill Nyarov out on left wing for Lambert. Gary Doak is there. Now Cashman to Smith. Flips it into the Montreal zone. Tremblay for the Canadians to Yvonne Lambert. Doak tying him up. It's centered, but Nyarov takes over for the Canadians to Risebrough. Here's Lambert with the loose puck. Takes a look, flipped it into the corner, and Cashman is back for Boston. Wayne Cashman leaving it for Doak. On the boards for Smith. Now it comes to center. Robinson getting it for the Canadians. Feeds to center ice. Doak knocked it down. Here's Miller into Jonathan. Dryden out of the net. Feeds it along the boards. Cashman knocked it down. Lambert bumped him. Cashman bumps back. Tremblay for the Canadians trying to clear it out, and it goes up over the glass. Tonight's Stanley Cup playoff game is coming to you from the Boston Garden.
How long do you want your car to last?
A million miles.
She's already done 89,000, and the only thing I've ever done to the engine is tune it up. Of course, I check it regularly, and the only motor oil I've ever used in my car is Quaker State.
Quaker State can't promise everyone the kind of mileage Julian Fry gets, but Quaker State helps cars last, and that's a fact.
I guess that's why Quaker State's the best-selling motor oil in North America.
14 minutes, 59 seconds left in regulation time. It is 2-1 Montreal. Sheppard against Lemaire on the faceoff. They both fell. Now Savard to Larry Robinson. To Guy Lafleur. Lafleur played it off the boards into the Bruin zone. Giebers plays the puck, so there'll be no icing. Now it's cleared around on the other wing. Savard held it in, but Sheppard comes up with it for Boston. Sheppard to Park. Out to Schmott. Back for Milbury. Now for John Marcotte. Across the line to Sheppard, trying to flip it in. Savard tipped it away. Loose along the boards. Here's Serge Savard. Well tied up by Milbury. Savard fired it around in the other wing, and here's Robinson to Lafleur. Marcotte stepped into him. Lafleur shoots it into the Bruin zone, and Park takes over. Brad Park. Drops it back. Here is Marcotte back to Brad Park. Park watched by Savard. Fired it in front. Oh, and Marcotte deflected it wide. Here's Schutt. Feeds to center. Off a skate. Lafleur races after it. Lafleur shoots, and Giebers came out about 10 feet to make the save. Park and who battle for it. Here's Sheppard, and now play is called as Robinson and Schmatz and Smith were all tangled up. Lafleur is going to the penalty box for Montreal. And so is Smith for Boston. This is Stanley Cup 78. It's coming from the Boston Garden.
For 3 months, Newfoundland asbestos miners in Bay Verte have stayed off the job protesting against unsafe working conditions. News magazine went to the company town and found the townspeople supporting the strikers.
I was shopping in Bramley City Center. They come to me, they say, Mr. We want to Bucky, we want to pull your beer.
Also, News magazine looks at racism. Canada's smug white majority isn't as liberal as Canadians might like to think. News magazine, Monday night at 10.
At 6:15 in this third period, Lafleur and Smith are off for slashing. It came following the play in which Lafleur shot one from the right side. Cheever's way out of the net, as you see. Made the save. Lafleur continued on against Smith, and from there right to the penalty box. Five aside again.
John Rattel against Jarvis. Face-off in the Bruin zone. Gainey and Doak jabbing with their sticks at one another. Rattel knocked off the puck. Here's Gainey. He tripped over Rattel. And they hold it against the boards, and the faceoff will be in the Bruin zone. 13:39 left in regulation time. 2-1 for the Canadians as we look at John Rattel. The Montreal goals by Risebrow and Robinson. Sheppard has scored for Boston. Here's Lapointe shooting one that's blocked. Now Rattel to Middleton off his stick, and Nyerop feeds to Gainey. Gainey got it into the Bruin zone. Milbury is there to Middleton. Middleton to Rattel. Number 10, John Rattel back to Gary Doak. Doak headmanning it to Middleton. Nyerop breaks it up at center ice. Gainey got it to the Bruin line, and Gary Doak has it. Over to Mike Milbury, to Rattel. Into the Montreal zone. Rattel lost it in his skates, and that put Middleton in ahead of the play offside at the Canadiens' blue line.
Chico, the Canadiens not dominating things from a territorial standpoint in this third period the way they did in the second. It's still a 2-1 hockey game, and that next goal is still looming large if it ever happens.
Well, that's right, and we talked about the fact that although Montreal has been dominating, or you see so often, Boston still is in a good position to get the goal, and I think Montreal knows that, and they're playing it a little bit tighter than they did in the second.
Here's Hull, checked from behind by Middleton, over on left wing for Milbury. Teams each a man short. Back is Hull for the Canadians. Milbury is in there, so is Rattel. Savard now for Montreal with Milbury. They get their elbows up high. Mike Milbury and Serge Savard. They've already had 70 minutes in penalties, most of it in the first period when we had 58 minutes assessed.
You know, Dan, we should give Chico credit. They did back off that sort of thing after that first period was over.
Well, they gave him a couple of warnings first.
They also gave LaFleur a shot on goal in that play in which Cheevers came up injured. They took one away from Uhl in the first period and gave it to LaFleur. That's the only shot LaFleur had through the first two periods. I guess he had another one right here in the last play before his penalty.
I noticed that they got a couple checkers out there. Montreal does, whereas Boston's going with their puck handlers.
Here's Lemire. He's out with Jarvis. Lemire dropping it to Robinson, now to Savard. Rattel and Middleton are the Bruin forwards. Canadians shoot it in. Here's Cheevers. Shot it on the board. Savard dumps it back into the corner. Now Milbury to Rattel, who got it to center, but Robinson takes over to Lemire. Lemire shoots it. He's wide by several feet. Bounces off the boards all the way back into the Montreal zone. Savard. Each team still a man short. Houle playing it to the Bruin line. McNabb leaving it for Milbury. Mike Milbury into Middleton. Middleton dropping it back, but Houle, who's played a strong game for the Canadiens, feeds to Lemire. And just off the mark, Cheevers fires to center. Here's Milbury. Over on the wing for McNabb. McNabb shoots. Dryden makes a pad save and then grabbed the loose puck and held it for the faceoff.
The Bruins have had some pretty good shots at Kenny Dryden in this period, but Chico, they're coming sort of unexpectedly. There's no sustained pressure in the part of Boston, but they have given Dryden a couple of pretty good tests in this period as they go for that equalizer.
And the one reason is that Dick, is that Kenny isn't also giving any rebounds. He's making the save, and he's also controlling the rebounds, which naturally cuts down for a lot of scrambles and second shot type situations. And that's very important, because I think Montreal is kind of, or wants to at least, keep it close checking, not with not many shots by either side.
6 seconds left in the penalties to Smith and LaFleur. Face off, McNabb and Jarvis. McNabb wins the draw. Jarvis ties them up, and the Canadians get the puck and get it out of the zone. O'Reilly dropping it back to Dope. Over to Smith. The penalized player is back on. LaFleur getting it into the center ice area. Jarvis for Ganey. Ganey got it into the Bruin zone, and the Boston captain, Wayne Cashman, number 12, takes over. For O'Reilly. Lambert skates him off and dumps it back into the Bruin zone. Dope hustling back. For O'Reilly. Mario Tremblay takes over for the Canadians. To Nyerop, he had trouble with a bouncing puck. O'Reilly chasing Nyerop. Nyerop to Tremblay. Cashman held it in. Cashman checked by Nyerop. Now Cashman has it again. To Smith. His shot stopped by Lapointe, who flips it to center right. Dope takes it there. He fired it around in the boards. Nyerop. To Tremblay. Cashman couldn't get it. Here's Smith. Into Cashman. Centered it higher up, clear to the line. O'Reilly. Puts it in front. Cashman, a shot. Rebound, McNabb. Scores! Peter McNabb!
Chico, they finally got some pressure inside the Canadian zone, and it paid off.
Well, that's right. When you sit back and try and play a tight checking game, that's what happens. Here's O'Reilly, who's been doing this all year, doing the muscle behind the net, gets it out front. Kenny makes the first save on Cashman. McNabb lifts the rebound over Kenny, and it's a tie game. Here it is again. You'll see O'Reilly come behind. He throws it out front, hits his player, rebound, up and over, tie game.
Peter McNabb's eighth goal of the playoffs. Comes with 10:41 left in the third period.
A lot of emotion has been stored up by the fans. They haven't had much to cheer about tonight since that early first period goal by Shepherd, but they have erupted here at the Boston Garden. 14,602, most of them Bruin fans, naturally, and they are giving their team quite an ovation after the tying goal. There it is. 10:41 left to play. Regulation time, and it's a 2-2 tie.
For McNabb, his 19th scoring point, and this is 13th playoff game this year. And his eighth goal. Now now the Bruins with the score deadlocked at two. Sut breaks up a play at the Canadiens' line, and it's offside anyway at the Montreal blue line. With the score, the Boston Bruins 2, the Montreal Canadiens 2. This is Stanley Cup 78.
Introducing the patented Mark Color from Arrow. Revolutionary, and that's fact. It's the first collar ever shaped to fit the human neck. Until now, men's collars have been cut like a tube. The Mark's ingenious shaping is like a cone. Result? A comfort like you've never experienced before. A new, crisp look with the neckband out of sight. The patented Mark Collar. Only by Arrow.
Peter McNabb on the Boston bench. They are still cheering. The goal that he scored to tie the game 2-2. Now Park, checked by Schutt at center ice. Here's Schutt in with Lemire. One man back, and Schmoss gets back. Schutt gets the backhander away anyway that trickled wide of the goal. Milbury tried to clear it. Here is LaFleur to Robinson. A drive, and Keever's just got a stick on it. Keever's back of the net. Feeds to Park. Now Lemire fired it in front of the net. No Montreal player was there. It was all the way back into the Canadiens' zone. Robinson. Canadiens 2 and the Bruins 2 as Robinson feeds the shot. Over to Lemire. Broken up by Schmucks. Now Robinson carried into the Bruins' zone on the top side at the Boston blue line. As we look again at Peter McNabb, his eighth goal of the playoffs, only LaFleur with nine has more. His 18th point of the playoffs, and only LaFleur with 20 has one more.
And another look from a different angle at that goal that was scored by McNabb. Chico, we've just been talking about pressure. It's the first time the Bruins really had any.
That was McNabb's 19th point of the playoffs, by the way. Just one less than LaFleur as the puck flips up over the boards at the Boston bench. And, of course, Peter McNabb, the son of Washington Capitol general manager Max McNabb, born in Vancouver, British Columbia, learned his hockey in the Los Angeles, California area, then went to Denver University. And what a success story he's been for the Bruins since coming from the Buffalo Sabres. Here's Rattel to Smith. Rick Smith with a backhander that Dryden gets that left glove on.
Well, right about now, the Canadians have to be looking back to those many scoring opportunities they missed in the second period, especially toward the end of the second period. That shot here a moment ago by Larry Robinson that ricocheted off Cheever's glove and just missed the open corner. That's really their best, really their only scoring chance in this third period. McNabb heading to a spot at the end of the bench. I don't know what that's all about over there. Wants a new stick.
Anxious to get out there again.
He's just
going
to give back his scoring stick and get his checking stick. Rattel and Jarvis. Here's Rattel. Oh, and Middleton in front of the net couldn't handle the pass. Canadians dumped it to center. Smith shoots it right back in. Nyrop for the Montreal Canadiens gives to Guy Lapointe. Here is Lapointe. Flipping it in, and Ganey over on left wing was in ahead of the play and offside at the Boston blue line.
It's amazing what momentum does. Again, now Boston's kind of playing the same game, Dick, that Montreal did in the second period. They're dumping it in and really freewheeling, really getting in there quick, and it's worked to their advantage.
Well, they got the chance at the momentum, if you will, and they had the man advantage to start this period, and they just carried on from there.
That's right.
Here's Robinson for the Canadiens, flipping it in along the board. Smith for Boston back. Tries to slap it out of there. Cournoyer held it in. Rattel gets it to center. Savard waits for his team to get onside. He didn't wait quite long enough. And we have an offside at the Bruin blue line with 8:47 left in regulation time.
You know, from an historical standpoint, only twice in the last 35 years has a team lost the first two games in the Stanley Cup Finals and then come back to win. Both times the Canadians in 66 and 71. That's in the last 35 years. The Bruins are making a pretty good run at it this year.
Jarvis, Cournoyer, and Ganey for Montreal. McNabb, O'Reilly, and Cashman for the Bruins. Park and Milbury on the Boston defense. Savard and Robinson on the Montreal defense. Here's Savard chasing back to Robinson. He got it to center. Milbury, the Boston area youngster, trying to clear it up. Cornwallé held it in. Milbury stepped into him. Park for the Bruins. To O'Reilly. Flips to center. McNabb gets away from Jarvis. Here's McNabb. Backhander off Dryden's shoulder. And they rule it was tipped by a high stick on the rebound.
That was a much better save than it appeared there. That was going right up in the top corner, right in the crook of Kenny's glove hand. And that's a very tough save. You'll see it here, right on the money. And Kenny made a good save there, and the puck popped up high, and Peter McNabb hit it with his high stick, consequently the faceoff outside the Montreal zone.
What does a goaltender who's about a foot shorter, such as yourself, do with a shot like that? Have to jump a little?
No chance in those.
Here's LaPointe. For Pierre Mondeau, trying to work around Brad Clark. It's centered. Hull was in front of the net, but it went off the skate. And now Milbury dumps it into the Montreal zone. Nyerop racing with O'Reilly. And Nyerop got to it first, so it's an icing call against the Boston Bruins. This Stanley Cup playoff game is coming to you from the Boston Garden.
These are top Ford trucks, champs in pickup gas mileage ratings again this year. Ford pickups with the optional 302 V8 and 4-speed manual transmission are the V8 gas engine mileage rating champs and the 6-cylinder mileage champs with better mileage ratings than the other conventional full-size pickups. And Ford Courier with the optional 5-speed overdrive transmission has the best mileage rating of the 4 top-selling compact pickups. See the tough mileage rating champs at your Ford or Mercury dealer now.
Dan Chico says he's only 6 inches shorter than Ken Dryden.
All I know is I'm taller than the other two guys in this booth.
Oh, I would say that. Are you taller than we are? Here's Mondeau, shoots, and he fired wide on the short side from the faceoff. Now McNabb. Broken up by Nyerop, the Boston fans hollering they thought there could have been a penalty against the Canadians. Hull tips it into the Bruins zone. Now McNabb for O'Reilly. In against Nyerop and LaPointe. O'Reilly drops it over, cutting in McNabb's backhander. Here's Dope. This shot goes off LaPointe. Cashman checked by LaPointe. Cashman still after it. Centers and Mondeau breaks out for Montreal. Pierre Mondeau, the Canadiens rookie, skated off by Smith. Cashman back to the goal. Hold on. Penalties coming up against Mondeau and Smith for something that occurred in behind the goal. And Yvonne Lambert bumps with the Bruins player. Live from the Boston Garden, the Stanley Cup playoffs.
Al, will you explain the Lotto Canada package to Sam?
Simple, Sam. Listen, you can win up to $5,000 if your number matches one of those chosen in the Mother's Day draw. Sam, you're not listening. Or you can win $1 million June 9th, or you can win right now. Instant money up to, look at that, $500. You want to play it again, Sam? You get three chances to win with one Lotto Canada package. Now, that's my kind of lottery.
That's my kind of lottery.
Make it yours.
Roughing penalties have been called against Pierre Mondeau of Montreal and Rick Smith of the Boston Bruins. Mondeau was the puck carrier. Now, this is what happened. The puck went around back of the net. They went into the corner as the camera followed the puck, but the referee followed them. So they are in the penalty box now. Smith of the Bruins and Mondeau of Montreal.
LaFleur at center against Shepard. Each team a man short. Park for Boston. 7:18 left in regulation time. The Bruins 2, the Canadiens 2. Mike Milbury over to Greg Shepard. Shooting, and he shoots wide by 3 or 4 feet. Now Mark Cox shot. Knocked down. Milbury flipped it in front. Savard is there for the Canadiens. Head Manning at the shot. Drops to LaFleur. Milbury knocks LaFleur down, and Marcotte gets the puck. Now to Shepard, in with Park. One man back. Shoots the Shepard, and Dryden kicked out the right pad. Another shot. That hit Robinson in front of the net. Milbury shot. Blocked by Robinson. Brad Park shoots. He scores!
Bruins lead it 3-2.
That was goes wild. Here's a shot. It's blocked by Larry Robinson in front. The puck comes loose. Park keeps his composure here. You'll see it go between Savard's legs and through Kenny's legs. Kenny never saw it. And again, he makes a good save here, and the puck's bouncing around. Another shot hits the body out front. Kenny can't see it. Savard stops it. Here you'll see it. It's going to go back to Park here. He keeps his composure. Like I say, makes a good play. A screened all the way and a good shot just inside the post.
Did Park look like an artist at work, or did he not?
Ooh, with all the crowd screaming, you know, your first reaction is just to fire it, but he took his time and made an excellent shot.
Right along the ice into the bottom left-hand corner with 6:40 left in regulation time. And the Bruins lead 3-2. And Brad Park scores his 8th goal of the playoffs. Here's Naira. Play gets underway. Now the Canadians trail 3-2. Milbury and Shepard get assists on the goal. Here's Middleton in the Boston zone. Dropping it off for Doak. Doak got it to center. Lemire for Rejao. Shooting. Keevers makes the save. Another save as he came out to get a pad on it. And now Middleton starts back for the Bruins. Into Rattel. John Rattel to Milbury. A drive. And that goes off LaPointe to the corner. Nyer up and Middleton battles for it. Here's Rattel to Milbury. Feeding it around in the boards. Dryden to Nyer up. Out to LaPointe. Milbury intercepted. Into Rattel. It hopped over his stick. Nyer up back to get it for Montreal. 5:40 left in regulation time. Back comes Gainey. Firing it in. Wide of the Bruin goal. Milbury golfs it back out to center. Now Robinson and Cashman bump at the blue line. But Gainey comes back for the Canadiens. Shot it onto an open wing at center ice. Milbury into Cashman. Cashman shoots. Dryden gets his right skate on it. And Savard flips it to center ice. Smith for the Bruins. Lost it to Mondeau. Shoots. Keevers a pad save. On Mondeau, back comes O'Reilly, and Savard hooked it away from him. Savard for Gainey. Gainey dropping it back. And McNabb cleared it off the boards to center. Doug Jarvis for Montreal, in for Gainey. Let the shot go. Keevers handles it easily. Smith beating it around on the boards. Cashman gets away from Savard. Now to O'Reilly. He couldn't get control of it. Park upended by Jarvis, and Robinson gives it to Savard. 4.5 minutes left in regulation time. Savard shooting it into the Bruins zone in the top side at the Boston blue line. And listen to this crowd at the Boston Garden. Brad Park scored the go-ahead goal at 13:20. Milbury and Shepard assisting. And look at it as Park threads the needle on a screen after some great pressure by the Bruins. And Chico, just prior to that goal, I was thinking the next stoppage in play, I was going to mention that the Bruins had taken it away from the Canadians, the way that Montreal did from Boston. Brad Park scoring. He is now one goal short of Bobby Orr's record of 9 goals by a defenseman in one playoff year. Orr set that record in 14 games in 1970. But the Bruins have dominated this third period the way the Canadians did in the second. And I know the question has to be, did the Canadians go into a shell defensively a little too early, perhaps? Look that way now. Of course, hindsight's 20-20. We're not out there.
4:27 left in regulation time. Bruins lead 3-2. Puck cleared into the Boston zone. Smith is back to get it. And it's icing against the Canadians with a face-off all the way back in the Montreal zone.
Well, no matter what happens here tonight, this pressure cooker of a hockey game is setting things up for the game at the Montreal Forum Tuesday night, Game 5. The Bruins could have the series tied by then, or the Canadians could be one win away from another Stanley Cup. 8 p.m. Eastern Daylight, our broadcast time, Game 5 on Tuesday.
The Bruins sending out Shepard, Marcotte, and Schmatz, the Canadians, with Lemire, Schutt, and LaFleur. LaPointe and Robinson on the Montreal defense. Park and Milbury out for Boston. Now they're making a change. Rick Smith coming out. He's going to replace Mike Milbury. Shepard against Lemire. 4:18 in regulation time remaining.
Deal a point for the Canadians, firing it off to center ice. Park. Over to Rick Smith. Now to Shepard. He dumps it into the Montreal zone. Mott is in there, but Shutt gets it loose for Montreal. Got it to center. Marcotte fired it right back in. Shutt to Robinson. Robinson to Guy Lafleur. Leads a four-man rush to center. Firing it into the Bruins zone and a soft side at the Boston Blue Line.
Canadians have been called offside, oh, I don't know, three or four times, Chico, in the third period, the last few minutes, actually. And it's a case of over-anxiousness every time. Gainey a couple of times. Steve Sheff there.
That's right. If Montreal does tie this game up, I don't think it's going to be Guy Lafleur, just for the fact that Don Marcotte is going everywhere Guy Lafleur is going. He's on him every second.
Marcotte had a great line the other day. He said, I don't really shadow Lafleur. I just play like a third defenseman when he's on the ice. Here is Smith to Shepard. Now to Schmatz. Shoots it into the Montreal zone. Dryden leaves her for Robinson. Up the middle to Lemire, but Park breaks it up. Here's Park. Flipping it into the Montreal zone. 3.5 minutes left in regulation time. Savard for Robinson. Feeds to Lemire. Now Lafleur. Into Shutt. Shutt trying to get around Park. Checked by Park before he could shoot. And Park flipped it off the board. Now Schmatz rolls it all the way into the Canadian zone. Savard back to touch it, and we get an icing call against Boston.
Well, Colombo is here. We did not know that. They just sent word up. Watch your monitor. Peter Falk.
On the edge of his seat, I might add.
That's something. He doesn't wear a raincoat all the time. Not at hockey games. Right. He the guy that wears the raincoat all the time?
That's it. Got it tonight.
I heard that he goes to some of the Kings games in L.A. He's a hockey fan.
Well, he is seeing one heck of a hockey game. 3:08 to play in the third period. Boston 3, Montreal 2. Canadians were leading 2-1. McNabb tied it from O'Reilly and Cashman at 9:19. Park gave them the lead from Milbury and Shepard at 13:20. Here's Lemire against Shepard. And they rule that Schmatz and Shutt were in the circle, so they whistle the play down right from the faceoff. Shepard and Lemire try for the draw again. Lemire gets it to Robinson, shoots high off the glass. Marcotte trying to clear it. Lapointe held it in, but Milbury beats to Schmatz at center. He got it to the Montreal line. Robinson feeding it into the Bruins zone, and Park is there. Robinson held it into Lafleur. Sliding across was Milbury to break it up. Now it is Schmatz who flips it into the Canadian zone. Lapointe back after it. 2:40 left in regulation time. Lemire firing it in to Shutt, and that's offside at the Bruins blue line again. With 2:35 left in the third period, and it's 3-2 Boston.
And we're always offside, Chico. The Canadians can't get anything going to keep it going. They move up the ice. They've been called offside time and again. It's uncharacteristic of them, but they are over-anxious, to be sure. Plus, the Bruins are hanging on defensively now.
Well, I know I'm anxious, so I can imagine how they are. I mean, the anxiety in this building right now is so intense, and it's going to take a super play, I think, to tie this game up.
Mondeau, Cournoyer, and Houle for Montreal against Rattel, Middleton, and Jonathan. Here's Cournoyer. Flips a long one in. Keevers firing it out himself to center ice, and Savard is on the Montreal defense with Bob Gainey. Beats to Cournoyer. Middleton intercepts. Dryden poked it away. Now it's centered, and Savard cleared it. Loose puck. Rattel can't get it. Rattel falls. Savard is able to clear it. Mondeau couldn't get it up. Middleton dropping it over. Now here's Houle for the Canadiens. Doak poked it away. And Middleton for the Bruins. Couldn't clear it, but as soon as the Canadiens touched it, it was called on a delayed offside.
I don't care who you're rooting for. You got to love this. I mean, like I say, you know Montreal's got the manpower, the explosiveness to tie it up. The Bruins are doing everything, second effort, everything to try and hold them off. We got a 2 minutes, minute 59, and it's just going to be intense right to the very last second.
Bob Gainey is out as an extra forward. He's playing left defense for the Canadiens. He and Savard are the defense combination. as the Canadians try and get the tie and goal here. Savard flipping it, and he flipped it up over the boards right near the Montreal bench. And we're down to 1:48 to play in regulation time.
The Canadians have not been able to develop any kind of a pattern, Chico, to try to set up the tying goal. It's been a case of maybe a shot getting through. More than likely not, the way the Bruins are playing. They're not letting them get organized at all right here. Of course, that's the name of their game, Boston's game, with a minute 48 left to play.
I would think the smaller rink may help them in a situation like
this,
too.
At times like this, yes.
Now the Canadians with Robinson and Lapointe on defense, Lemaire, Lafleur, and Shutt up front. Bruins have Sheppard, Marcotte, and Schmatz, Milbury, and Park on defense. A minute 48 left in the third period. Bruins leading 3-2 as Lapointe fires it into the Boston zone. Lemaire and Park fight for it on the board. Schmatz got away from Robinson. Robinson recovered and held it in. Keevers leaves it for Park. He feeds it out on the board. Marcotte check. Lafleur to Shutt. Shutt bouncing it in front. Here's Lemaire to Lapointe. And he was checked by Marcotte before he could shoot. Park trying to fire it up. Lafleur held it in. Into Shutt. Back in front. Lapointe took a whack at it. Park sprawls and Keevers sprawls. And they freeze the puck off to the side of the Bruins goal.
Well, there's what we were talking about, Chico. Had not been happening. The Canadians with pressure.
We were screened from up here, but you'll see another excellent save. Pressure save by Jerry Cheevers there coming out. And then Brad Park giving him a lot of help by covering up the rebound.
A minute and 13 seconds left in regulation time. Dryden comes halfway out to the blue line. Now heads for the Montreal bench. They're going to take Dryden off with a minute 13 to play and go with six attackers. It is 3-2 for the Bruins. And the Canadians are taking off the goaltender and going with a six-man ganging attack. Lemaire will take the faceoff with Sheppard in the Boston zone. They get it to Robinson. To Lafleur, who couldn't hold it in. Lafleur hustling back. Now Schmatz intercepts it, a backhander. That hit Lafleur. Robinson. Out to Shutt. Canadians with six attackers. Jumping into the Bruins zone. Marcotte played it back to the Montreal line. 54 seconds left in regulation time. Here's Lafleur. Flipping it into the Bruins zone. Keevers out of the net. Fired it over onto the other corner. Lapointe. Milbury battle for it. And Milbury falls on top of the puck of the faceoff. Will be in the Bruins zone with 41 seconds left in regulation play.
On the last faceoff, it worked perfectly for the Canadians. They won the draw. Back to the point, across to Lafleur. He mishandled the puck and lost control of it. There is the empty Montreal net. 41 seconds remaining. Kenny Dryden looking on from the Canadians bench as Scotty Bowman has his six attackers out and Don Cherry has his defenders. The faceoff will match Lemaire and Sheppard.
Lemaire, Shutt, Savard, Lafleur, Lapointe all up front. Robinson back at the blue line. Sheppard and Lemaire on the faceoff. And they rule the puck was dropped unfairly. The Bruins have Sheppard, Schmatz, and Marcotte. Park and Smith on defense. 41 seconds left in regulation time. Here's Smith for the Bruins, trying to clear it. Lemaire into the corner for Lapointe. Sheppard, they shoot. They score! Guy Lafleur, I believe.
Either Guy Lafleur or Serge Savard, the puck was bouncing crazily.
33 seconds left and the Canadians tie it.
And while the Canadians pour off the bench, I see Scotty Bowman just shaking his head. There's a Canadian fan. He's not a member of the team. Well, pulling the goaltender often doesn't work, Chico Resch, but this time it did. Oh, it's Lafleur, I think, Dan. I'm with you. I really couldn't tell at the time the angle we had. They were both swinging at the puck. Maybe we can see it here.
Watch Steve Shutt here. He knocks it out of the air. A great play to get it out front. And Serge Savard hit it just before Guy Lafleur was there also. But Serge hit it and it kind of chipped it up over Jerry's glove.
19-27. Lafleur scoring his 10th playoff goal. Lapointe and Lemaire, I don't know about that assist call. That's not the way the replay looked. Here we go, Dan.
Oh, you'd think that Lapointe and Shutt would get assists. It's tied. 25 seconds left. Lafleur was credited with the goal. Milbury trying to clear it. Jarvis held it in. Puck in behind the Bruin goal. Here's O'Reilly. Now Hull centering it. And Cashman for the Bruins intercepts to O'Reilly. 10 seconds left. O'Reilly shot, and it goes off Dryden's skate. Cashman to the corner. Hull for Montreal to Gainey. Now Milbury knocks it out. And the buzzer goes. We are headed for overtime. The goal that tied the game, scored by LaFleur, although Savard very easily could have been credited with it as well. Lapointe and Lemire get assists at 19:27. And I would think that Steve Schutt would be given an assist because he seemed to tip the puck off to the side of the crease. Let's have a look at the tying goal again by the Canadians.
Lapointe just whacks at it, and then Steve Schutt hits it. See, and Serge Savard hit it up. Now, I couldn't tell. Maybe Guy got his stick on it a second time as it was going up in the air. Here you'll see it. See here now, there it's off Jerry's stick. It's coming down, and you'll see Serge. See, watch Serge. Well, when we run it the other way, you might get a chance to look at it. Now, watch Serge's stick, number 18, get hit in there just before Guy. See there? And it goes up, but does Guy hit it again in as he screens out the play? Well, we don't know. We'll have to wait.
Well, the important thing is that the Canadians tied it with 20 or 33 seconds left, and we are headed for overtime, and we are also headed downstairs to Dave Hodge.
Thank you very much, Dan, Dick, and Chico. I'm with Lou Nanny, and Scotty Bowman was shaking his head. That's what everybody has been doing, is I'm sure the Boston fans are doing it for a different reason than Scotty Bowman, but... LaFleur gets credit for the goal, and as we watch that replay, it might easily have been LaFleur hitting it after Savard. Anyway, what did you think of the third period? Tide was turning in all directions, and then the Canadians tie it up.
Well, Dave, it's surprising that Montreal was able to come back after Boston had all that momentum. They come back, they tied the game, then they go ahead. It seemed like they were checking them rather effectively. They were keeping them out of their zone. But when Montreal pulled a goaltender, they were flooding the boards right away. They knew the puck was going to come out. And they were able to capitalize on it. They stole the puck, and when you knock him in out of the air, you're doing something right. Besides, when you get that many goals during the season, you know how to put them in a net. Montreal can never be counted out, and they just proved it again.
That might be the only team that could have forced an overtime in that situation after the Bruins had scored a couple of goals and really seemed to flatten the Montreal Canadiens. Let's go back now and hear more from Chico and Dick.
All right, Dave, a 3-3 tie. Chico, from a goaltender's standpoint, you look down the ice and you see the other net is empty, and you look ahead and you see six skaters instead of the normal five. What's the reaction?
Well, I think it's the same reaction as every other player probably has. You're excited, you're frantic. You realize what usually happens in that situation is if they're going to score, it's usually going to come on a scramble, a screenshot, hit somebody in front. So what you want to try and do is cover low if you can. You got to stay down on the puck because there's going to be bodies flying in front of you and everybody's going to be throwing themselves in front of it. And that's pretty much what happened on that tying goal.
I don't know when I've seen a goal it was the case like that one was of follow the bouncing puck, because from the time Steve McGee Lapointe let it go from the corner of the rink, I don't think it ever hit the ice.
No, and the interesting thing is it came in from the corner and Greg Sheppard took a baseball swing at it. He happened to miss it, but Guy Lapointe was able to corral it. He kind of passed it over about 2 feet off the ice, and Steve Schutt, who does this so well, we've always talked about it, how he knocks pucks out of the air. He just laid it out front, and Serge Savard, excuse me, I keep thinking it's him, but Guy LaFleur, they credit it to, just kind of chipped it up and over Jerry's arm, and I'm sure Jerry was disappointed because it wasn't a hard shot, but it's the type of thing you're anxious, and you could see him scrambling there trying to get the handle on it, and it kind of just went plunk into the net.
And that's spoken on behalf of the goaltenders union. Plunk into the net. That's the worst sound in the world, right?
Isn't it?
All right, Dave Hodge is standing by downstairs with a very well-known gentleman, a paper lion who tried to play goal for the Bruins in the exhibition season or before the regular campaign. So here's Dave.
That man is George Plimpton, who seems set trying to do everything he can in life. Does this game, watching it for you, fill another void?
Well, it's been quite a void, hasn't it? I didn't want to be down here at all. I just can't believe what's happened there. 41 seconds, was it?
19:27, 33 seconds remaining in the game. Your comments suggest that your allegiance to the Bruins, which started in preseason, is continuing tonight.
It's enormous. In fact, I hit the man on my left by mistake out of anguish, threw a beer over the press. I behaved very badly.
George, what did you find out about the Boston Bruins being as close as you were to them and actually putting on the sweater and playing in an exhibition game for fun, shall we say? Maybe you wouldn't say that, but what kind of a feeling do you get being around these people?
Well, it wasn't fun being in the barrel, as they say, or the nets, but I must say that getting to know that team and getting to experience their humor and their comradeship and what it is to be part of a team is one of the richest experiences a participatory journalist that I've ever had. It's no wonder that I've misbehaved in the press box. I mean, one gets as close to a team doing that as one does to a family. And it's very hard to see what happened just now happened. But they're going to come back in the overtime, I think. I watched the overtime the other night in a place called the Explorers Club, up in a lonely room there watching on television. And I let out such a cry of anguish that I thought the beasts on the wall had somehow going to pee. There was servitors down below came running up to see what was going on down there. So I feel terribly strongly about this team. I apologize to all the Canadian folk there, but my heart is with these people, I must say.
George, do you feel a little closer to Jerry Cheevers than to anybody else, considering the fact that was your position, if I might say that?
Well, he kept telling me to stand up all the time, and which I couldn't do. I mean, I can barely skate. But my goodness, what a job he's done in there tonight. Plus the fact that he has this bad knee, as you know, so that sort of a double thrill that he's giving everybody, crippled on one hand and yet playing, I think, the game of his life. Extraordinary to see.
How would playing at goal or playing goal in the NHL compare to a myriad of other things that you've done?
Well, it's very peaceful when the puck is at the other end. You can sort of stand there and you do a little housekeeping and so forth. But I want to tell you, when it comes down to your end, and there are those 10 people with those barrel trousers and those strange disembodied faces, and you're supposed to see the puck in there, I don't know of anything that's more horrifying in sports. And it doesn't stop. In football, once the play is over, there's a whistle, and you can sort of lie there and you know that you've got a little bit of breathing space. But when that puck moves as fast and as constantly as it does, I don't know of anything that puts as much pressure on a participant.
George, when the winning goal goes in, we will have a good idea of what you'll be doing, whether it be Boston and you're cheering, or the Canadians and there is more anguish. It has been very pleasant for us to have you with us, even if you did not want to see the overtime take place. George Plimpton, our guest in the first overtime intermission as we get set for a period of 20 minutes or less that could decide this fourth game of the Stanley Cup Final. And we'll return with the Stanley Cup playoffs in just a moment.
The Watson Report does a lot of jobs. At its best, the show is an accountability program where people who have undertaken a responsibility for some aspect of our national life are made to account for that responsibility.
You have said for some time that controls...
The Watson Report, examining the issues that affect all Canadians, Wednesday night at 10:30 on CBC.
I've had this car for about 3 years and 130,000 miles, and I look after it. Like using STP oil treatment. A lot of drivers I know add STP to their engines. It gives your car that extra care I like having, whether I'm driving 12 hours a day or just around the block.
You free?
Yeah, get in. I never get a break, but my car sure does with STP oil treatment.
Couldn't be more dramatic circumstances to this game. The Canadians with a goaltender out tying it up in the final minute to force the overtime, which we are preparing to watch. And it was overtime that put this man's team out of the playoffs in the Stanley Cup quarterfinals. Bill Torrey, the general manager of the New York Islanders. You perhaps have the same nightmares of a goal by Lanny McDonald as George Plimpton is thinking about with the goal by Guy Lafleur. What goes through a neutral observer's mind as we get set for this overtime?
Well, if you're the team that has been caught, it's murder. If you're the team that has caught them, it's you're willing to accept it.
Are you suggesting there is a lot of momentum attached to the fact that the Canadians are coming into the overtime on the high?
Well, as you were mentioning a minute ago, in the game so far, the momentum has really kind of flip-flopped. It seemed to be going one way for a while and then came back the other way, and Boston getting the go-ahead goal, they seem to really be coming on strong. And then who can do it better than Montreal? They've done it so many times. So that I think it's a very difficult thing to say at this moment where the momentum is. But I think you'll see in this period that both teams are going to have to be a little careful. It's a very, very pivotal game.
Bill, we're suggesting that nobody can be surprised or should be that the Canadians were able to come back and tie that game up in those circumstances. But are you surprised that the Bruins won the third game of the series so convincingly and have come so close tonight to winning it in regulation time?
Well, I think any time Montreal is beaten convincingly, you have to think about it a little bit, but I'm certainly not surprised that the Bruins are into this series. They play hard. They have nobody on their team that's willing to give an inch. And no, I don't think you can say it's a surprise in that regard. I think that the fact that they won the game the way that they did might be a little bit of a surprise. And yet they had sound goalkeeping. They played their positions well. They did all the things that you have to do in order to beat Montreal. And all they really did is prove that the Blue Blanc Rouge is human after all.
Well, the Montreal Canadiens are making believers out of any non-believers that that might have existed. Jerry Cheevers is playing that challenging game again. If you were looking at it from Montreal's point of view, would there be anything you would be telling your shooters that might counteract that?
Well, it does seem that way, but then again, if you look at the chances, really he had, you know, he's gambling a little bit, and yet if you look at his timing, he's really making the perfect play. And I think your colleague there, Chico Resch, should probably back me up on that. He doesn't do that all the time.
You would be very impressed with the job Chico is doing, as I know you're impressed when he plays goal for your team. Bill Torrey, a pleasure to see you in our overtime intermission, and we'll get to Lou Nanny again in a moment. Stanley Cup 78 continues after this message.
Raindrops keep falling on my head.
The voice, B.J. Thomas.
Hey, won't you play another somebody done somebody wrong song?
The album, the B.J. Thomas Collection. 26 sensational hits in a giant two-album set.
And she'd sing and shine. Na, 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 it'll be all right. Deep in the eyes of a New York woman, I just can't help believing when she smiles up soft and gentle with a trace of misty morning and the promise of tomorrow in her eyes. I'm hooked on a feeling.
In the stores now, two record sets, $6.99, tape or cassette, $7.99. The 26 hit B.J. Thomas Collection.
Down by the old,
down by the old mill stream,
old mill stream, where I first met you, 16.
If you have to have a meeting and can't go, a conference call gets different people in different cities together to work out whatever they're working on. Just dial 0, ask for the conference operator. She sets it all up.
Three-three as we prepare for overtime in Game 4 from the Boston Garden. Montreal tying it up in the final minute with the goaltender out. And Lou Nanny has been player, coach, and general manager with the Minnesota North Stars as a coach. Do you ever wonder about when is the right time to pull the goaltender, and could there be a better time the way things turned out than when Scotty Bowman tried?
Well, some people like to pull them later, and of course, some people might even pull them earlier. But it's a feeling that you have when you think that this is your last chance, now you pull a goaltender. And of course, it's proven right for Scotty, but there's no doubt he's going to pull him in that last minute because he's got nothing to lose. But, you know, it's all a sense of timing. I've seen people pull him as early as a minute and 45 seconds to go. And when that happens, you know, you start wondering if you're giving up too much time.
Perhaps he thought he might not get another faceoff in the Boston zone the way the game was going.
Well, I think he pulled him around a minute 13, and that's pretty precise. When you're around a minute 10, you're going all out, and you know your players can go hard for a minute and 10 seconds, and you have your big strong ones out there like he did. He had the three big defensemen to control the boards in the corners, and he had his gunners out front, and they just paid off. And as you know, he never count Montreal out, and it proved it again.
Heller was Serge Savard. There was Guy Lafleur in front of the net. As far as we know, it is still Lafleur who was officially credited with the goal that sends us to overtime. Lou, I was all set to hold you to a prediction that the Boston Bruins, if they won this game, would win the Stanley Cup, and I still might. Were you surprised that we're sitting here And was there anything that you saw in the play that led up to the goal that might have suggested it was going to go in the net?
Well, first of all, I am surprised that Montreal was able to tie it up, because Boston coming back, as I said earlier, could not only tie it, but go ahead and then checking very effectively, efficiently, not giving them any chances until the last 2 minutes. It seemed to me that Boston was going to have enough to beat them. What surprised me was the way they lined up for that last faceoff. You know, Montreal's got six people out there. So what they try and do is set a screen up in front of the net and they try and get the shot back in the slot to their fellow who's going to take it. At that point, it was LeFleur, and he's going to take the shot on net. Boston elected to pull a defenseman back of the circle, leaving only four up, and the right wing was open. And when the puck came back, he tried to go back around the boards with it against the grain. They blocked it. Montreal now is going right to the boards. They know how they're coming out. And I'm thinking, had he been up on the hash mark, he'd be skating full stride into it. He could have got a lot on it, on the glass and out of the zone.
Okay, thank you, Lou Nanny. We prepare for overtime, 3-3, Canadiens and Bruins.
Dan Kelly, Dick Irvin, and Chico Resch up in the broadcast booth as we head for sudden death overtime. We review the scoring in the game for you. Back in the first period, the Bruins took an early lead. Shepard scoring at the 25-second mark from Marcotte. Risebrow tied it from Trombley and Ganey at 3:26. The only goal of the second period, Robinson at the 7-minute mark. And Montreal led 2-1. Then the third period, Boston tying it. They got goals from McNabb to tie it, and then Clark to put them in the lead, and then the tying goal by LeFleur for Montreal at 19:27. Here we go. Sudden death overtime. Bruins and the Canadiens tied at 3. It's Schmucks tied up by Schutt. Now along the boards, Lemire dumping it into the Bruins zone. Milbury is there, and LeFleur into poor check on him, and we'll have a faceoff in the Boston zone.
Man, what a setup this is for Game 5. Tuesday night in Montreal, no matter what happens. 8 o'clock, our broadcast time. LeFleur tying it up in the third.
And, of course, LeFleur won Game 2 of the overtime goal. Here is Park flipping it. Robinson unable to hold it in. Robinson, number 19, on the Montreal defense with LaPointe. Robinson for LaPointe on right wing. Feeds to Lemire. Long shot, Cheevers handles it. Now it is Park flipping to center. LaPointe knocked it down to Robinson. Larry Robinson tried to set up LeFleur. Milbury hustles back for Boston. Milbury trying to get away from LeFleur. Now Lemire knocked it down on the boards. Milbury has it again to Shepard. Now to Marcotte. Got the center, shot intercepted. Long shot, Cheevers steers it to the corner. LeFleur in after it. Milbury blocks his attempted pass out. Milbury and LeFleur continue to fight for it. Now Schmatz and Robinson come in. Here is Shepard. Shepard out with Marcotte and Schmatz on the Bruin forward line against Lemire. Now the Canadians changing on the fly as the Bruins dump it. It hits Schmatz and he's offside. And on the pass from inside the Boston blue line.
Well, the first shots of the overtime period have both been stopped by Jerry Cheevers. The Canadians doing the firing. Lemire, in particular, from outside the blue line, had the hardest shot. Cheevers has been there before.
In regulation time, the Canadians outshot Boston 24-23. Jarvis against Rattel. Cornwallier had a chance at it. Now Jarvis over to Ganey. Ganey flipping it in along the boards. Dokes is there, and he got it to center ice. Savard to Nyerov. Now to Cornwallier. To the Bruin line. Dokes for Middleton. Into Rattel. Rattel skated off by Nyerov, and the Canadians clear it to center. Dokes for Boston. Trying to flip it back in, and he flipped it right up over the glass.
Well, Chico, you've made several predictions. Who's going to win the hockey game, and who's going to score the winning goal?
Well, I haven't been right in any of them, so I don't want to jinx anybody, either team, by making a prediction, because I'm sure it'll come. It won't be true.
Don't bother asking me. I'm zero for 43.
I'm just saying, we've been around a little bit longer, Dick. Here's Jonathan. We've been wrong a little more, I guess you could say. Here's Ganey now. Dope knocked it off his stick. And now it is Nyerov to Savard. For center ice. Jarvis fires it into the Bruins zone. We play 2 minutes of overtime. Dope trying to flip it up. Now Pierre Mondeau knocking it down into Cornwallier. Smith intercepts. Rick Smith leads a four-man rush into Middleton. Middleton lets the shot go, and Dryden got his pad on it. And the Canadians flirt. Here's Poole shooting at the center. Park knocked down by Mondeau, but Rattel gets it. Into Middleton. Now to Jonathan. Jonathan trying to get turned around. Jonathan tied up on the play. Canadians Mondeau tried to clear it. Park held it in. Fired it around in the boards. Milbury moves in from the left point. Bumps with Houle. Now Cornwire. To Mondeau. He couldn't catch up with it, and Stan Jonathan has it for Boston. He scooped it back to center. Savard shooting it right back into the Bruins zone. Stevers leaving it there. Here's Park for Jonathan. He pokes it to center. McNabb racing after it. McNabb checked from behind. And LaFleur has it for Montreal. To Steve Schutt. Schutt shooting. Stevers makes a pad save and goes to one knee and smothered the loose puck.
Well, it's going to be interesting to see the referee Myers and his reaction. As Lou Nanny said before the overtime the other night in Montreal, you have to get mugged out there pretty well before you get a penalty. Back of the net, look at Steve Schutt's long shot. And really not much trouble for Cheevers on that one. That's easy for me to say, Chico.
Yeah, when the pressure's on, every save, I don't care if it's a lob from the other end, it's tough.
Lemaire against Shepard. Puck near the Bruin goal. Cheevers cleared it on left wing to Marcotte. LaFleur checked him. Smith has it for Boston. Flips it into the Montreal zone. Robinson is there, trying to clear it. Shepard and Schutt battle for it. Schutt clears to center, and Smith beat LaFleur to it. Cleared it back into the Canadian zone. Robinson, Gigi Lapointe. Lapointe flipping it into the corner in the Bruins zone. Schmotz for the Boston Bruins back to beat LaFleur to it. LaFleur checked him from behind, centered, but Shepard intercepts. Shepard with Marcotte and Schmotz. Robinson breaking it up. Fires to center. Now Dope to Greg Shepard. Shepard over on left wing to Marcotte. A high shot off the glass. Schmotz digs into the corner. Robinson for Montreal. Hit the side of the net with it. Now Schmotz trying to clear it. Over on the other wing, and Steve Schutt is there for Montreal. He fires it into the Bruins zone, and Milbury is back for Boston. To Shepard. Shepard for O'Reilly. He's checked, and Lambert has it for Montreal. Yvonne Lambert trying to move around Park, who skates him off. Now O'Reilly tying up Lambert back of the net. Park is there. So is Mario Tremblay. And they hold it for a face-off behind the Bruin goal. The face-off will be off to the right of Jerry Cheever.
We have not had a stopwatch on Brad Park in this series, but he must be the man who's logged more ice time than anybody else on either team.
Sure made a nice play there. It wasn't the shot that was dangerous. The danger there was Lambert getting it out front, and Brad didn't allow him to do that.
McNabb on this face-off. Wins the draw from Risebrow. Bruins get up to center ice. Here's O'Reilly. Fired it off the board. Dryden had it hop over a stick. McNabb in after it. Tries to center. It comes in front. Brad Park fanned on the shot as Lambert checked him as he went to shoot. Now Tremblay to Risebrow to Lambert. And Milbury breaks up the two-on-one. Back comes Cashman with McNabb. Cashman moving in to McNabb. Tipped away. And the Canadians start back. Risebrow with Lambert. Two-on-one break to backhander, and Cheevers to save, and Risebrow and a backhander.
Well, they opened up right there. Chico, that seems to be the rule rather than the exception in this day and age of hockey. The overtimes used to drag on, be long, defensive battles. Nowadays, they open up a lot more.
That's right. Let's get it over with is kind of what they're saying. The big play here is we couldn't see it, but behind the play is Wade Cashman hooking Yvonne Lambert and not even allow him to get free and be that second man on that rush.
Jarvis against Rattel, face off in the Bruins zone. We've played 4:57 of the first overtime. The Bruins win, they tie the series. The Canadians win, they go ahead 3-1. Jarvis wins the face-off, but Middleton gets to the puck. Here's Middleton to Jonathan with Rattel, and Robinson broke up a dangerous rush. Now a loose puck for Jarvis, and it's cleared away by Gary Doe. Jonathan for Boston to Rattel. In for Middleton. Trying to get around Robinson. Lapointe breaks it up. Borghini too far ahead. Doak is there to clear it. Now Jarvis carried in with Deeney already in across the blue line offside.
Some of the players on both teams are showing great dexterity and knocking the puck down out of the air and making plays. We saw it on the Canadiens' tying goal. We've seen it two or three times in this overtime session. Right there, Middleton knocked the pass down. The Canadiens sending out Lemaire, Schutt, and LaFleur. The Bruins with Shepherd, Schmotz, and Marcotte. Now Schutt kicking it into the Bruins zone. Park is there. Park tried to clear it. Knocked down. Here's Lemaire. Shoots. Cheevers gets his stick on the low drive. Back come the Bruins. Marcotte to Schmotz. Schmotz moving in. Shoots it and it goes off Robinson over the glass. What a stop by Jerry Cheevers. That's the same end of the rink where Jacques Lemaire beat him for the cup-winning goal last year. This time, a quick chance for Lemaire, Chico.
The great thing about this is when you see a guy wind up like Lemaire, the tendency is to pull up a little bit, but there you'll see Cheesy's right down on the puck, makes a great save. There's no room for error. Puts the puck in the corner, the rebound where it should be, and just an excellent save, again, under heavy, heavy pressure.
Not safer up here, isn't it, Chico? Talk about the pressure.
Well, it might be safer, but I would still sooner be down there.
Canadiens winning 15 of 20 overtime games against the Bruins. Here's Jarvis out for the faceoff with Shepherd. Jarvis wins this draw, and Robinson starts back for Montreal. Larry Robinson shooting it into the Bruins zone, and Park goes back for the Bruins. To Marcotte, held in at the point by Guy Lapointe. His shot hit Shepherd, and the Bruins' Marcotte was able to clear it. Lemaire for Montreal, long shot. Cheevers makes a pad save with his left leg. Bruins clear it back to center. Lapointe feeding the shot. Schutt's long shot. Racing in is Lemaire. He changed hands and shot wide. Here's Schmotz trying to clear it. Robinson's blocked. Blocked by Park. Out to Shepherd with Marcotte. Shepherd moving in. Centers to Schmotz. He scores! Schmotz! And the series is tied at two games apiece.
Shot from right there, Dan. One of the best shots on the Boston team. He used Larry Robinson, who's slowly making his way over to the gate. Used him as a screen. Kept the puck low on Ken Dryden's glove side. And just an excellent shot and an excellent play by Greg Shepherd and pass to set up that goal. And this crowd,
listen to that cheer going up as the Bruins leave the ice. The Bruins moved the puck up very well on that play, Chico. They got it out of their own zone. Looked as though Shepherd had gone too wide to make a play, but he saw Schmotz. And he fires it by Larry Robinson, as you say. And Robinson was the screen. There's no doubt about that. And another cheer for Bobby Schmotz, as I think he's going down to talk with Dave Hodge skating out. There's a close-up look at Kenny Dryden. He saw it, but too late. The puck was by him. I'm sure he didn't see it. Schmotz played it so well, and Dryden skated out, commiserated with Larry Robinson, who took a long time to get up after he had sprawled on the ice to try to block the shot. Well, the Bruins come back. These teams aren't following form, you know. They always say the team that ties it late goes on to win. It didn't work for the Bruins in Montreal last week, and it didn't work for the Canadiens here tonight. And the series is tied 2-2.
Schmotz wins the game for Boston. I believe Shepherd and Park will get assists. And so the final score, the Boston Bruins 4 and the Montreal Canadiens 3.
Mondays on CBC, first it's MASH when Hawkeye and BJ get together to share some wit and wisdom.
Read the alphabet soup.
How would you like a club in the mouth?
Then join Front Page Challenge as big names in the news try to stop Gordon Sinclair, Betty Kennedy, and Pierre Burton.
No. 1975.
Yes.
1975. Are you a lady?
Yes.
Followed by super special top-notch entertainment running from rock to the blues to comedy and a whole lot more. Mondays are fun on CBC, starting with MASH at 8.
Well, the excitement in here, or perhaps the hectic pace, is just the same as it is out there on the ice, with the Boston Bruins winning and Bobby Schmotz taking a well-deserved sip, and we want to look at the goal, as I'm sure you would like to see it coming back. Bobby, the best shot possible, I think. Beat Ken Dryden just as cleanly as you could want. And when we see it come up, why don't you just talk us through it?
Oh, I have to see it. Donnie Marcotte gets the puck, and he's getting it up to Shep here. And as we're coming, and I'm coming late, and I'm trying to hang back, and Sheppy just lays it over Marcotte, and I just shoot it on the ice, and I think that's Larry Robinson going down. I don't think Dryden's seen it now. It's the only one that I got on the ice. I usually shoot them high, and it went in.
Intentionally on the ice with Robinson there or not?
I just got it. I just tried to shoot it as soon as I got it, and fortunately enough, it went in.
Bobby, what was the feeling in the dressing room after the Canadians had tied it so dramatically in the final minute of the third period?
It wasn't the best feeling, but we said, hey, we got it this far right now, and let's go out and give it our best try, and whatever happens, going to happen.
Did you have the feeling that the entire series was riding on what would happen in the overtime?
Well, definitely. I mean, going back to the building 3-1, you know, no matter how hard you want, that's still a mental block on you. So we knew we had to try to win it, and we didn't really want to open up with these guys. They've got a lot of offensive scorers on it, so we wanted to keep it tight checking, and fortunate enough, we got a couple breaks.
You have some confidence because of the fact the way you played in game number two. Many people thought the Bruins could have and perhaps should have won it in the regulation time. It went to the overtime, and of course, Montreal had the better of the play. But does that help you going back to the Forum?
Well, that was the best game that we played in the last couple of years against them, was that, excuse me, that second game, and gave us a little, I don't know really what you'd call it, a little more encouragement and everything. And we came in here, we played a pretty good game, the third game, and then tonight it was a struggle, I'll tell you that.
Well, there's a celebration in that dressing room now. We'll let you get to it, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Bobby Schmatz, who scores the winning goal for the Boston Bruins, and now the prediction can be retold. Lou Nanny said if the Bruins win tonight, they win the Stanley Cup. You still think that?
Well, David, I have to think that. I feel if they believe they can do it. I know that they really haven't been outclassed except for parts of that first game, and that could have been because they were tired coming back from Philadelphia series. I feel right now that the pressure is on Montreal. Montreal hasn't faced this kind of situation in a couple of years, and all of a sudden, when it's thrust upon you, they could react differently. Boston right now has nothing to lose. They've proven it, and I feel that they're going to go all the way.
Okay, that's Lou Nanny's prediction for the remainder of this series. Game number 5 will be in Montreal, and we hope you'll join us for that on Tuesday, a starting time of 8 o'clock Eastern time, and for now, we say goodnight from Boston. Canada, brought to you by Ford of Canada, on behalf of Ford and Mercury dealers from coast to coast. Ahead, and participating retailers and record companies in Canada. The Bank of Nova Scotia, with nearly 1,000 branches across Canada to serve you. This program is protected by copyright and is intended solely for the entertainment and enjoyment of the viewing audience. Reproduction by any means, in whole or in part, without the expressed written permission of Hockey Night in Canada is prohibited.
CBC.